Jim is scheduled to make a fourth film in the series. He did make the film Worker's Voice, which is about kind of the overall involvement of labor in the major political changes that took place during the period of change we're talking about here, the shedding of the copper collar. And then he also did a film on Ron Richards, who was one of the more important people during this period, who's not available to speak for himself. And so Ron was a good friend of, very, very good friend of Jim's and mine, and another mentor of mine. And then also with Marilyn Maney, Ross, who was, we're talking about the impact of these changes that were going on and how they affected the Democratic Party as a structure. The fourth one that he'll be filming is the one with John Board, the former president of the
MEA,
about what was going on in the legislature in the 1970s in terms of improvement of labor law during the 1970s, very specific to the legislature. So Jim will have his thumbprint on the series in terms of being in four films. And as I said, if you had to watch one of them, watch the first one, Worker's Voice. I hope you got a chance to do that. If you watch any of the others, fine. I think they're really good pieces of work. Jim has his thumbprint on this in a big way, because Jim is an extraordinarily important person when it comes to the changes that took place. Now, you may recall when we started this series, this class, we talked about the question of whether or not individual human beings make a difference, whether history is made by people or people are essentially controlled by history. And the answer was kind of a little of both, right? But that being said, Jim Murry is without question an individual human being with leadership qualities who personally made a big difference in this period. I would cite as evidence of that in 1982, right at the end of the Crucible of Change period, the Lee newspapers did this survey. They identified 100 leaders in Montana. They surveyed the 100 leaders with an open-ended question: who are the five most influential or powerful Montanans? That was it. No name suggested, nothing. Just here's an open-ended question. And so those 100 people responded back to Lee newspapers, and they did a series. And in that series, they had the five most influential or powerful people in Montana in 1982, which would have been at the culmination of this period of change. And to no great surprise, the first person on that list was Ted Schwinden, who, in addition to being governor at that time in the early 1980s, had been the lieutenant governor. And remember all the things we learned about Ted's involvement in this period of change. And so he was number one. The number two most powerful person in Montana, as adjudged by these 100 leaders, was Jim Murry. And I think there's no question in my mind that that was an appropriate designation. And Jim's been is a very close personal friend of mine, and we kind of hang on to each other because, you know, you don't get many good friends, and especially if you're in the business we've been in, you know, you know, it's easier to make enemies.
You know, always keep.
But more importantly to me, Jim was always a mentor. Because I learned at his knee, mostly by doing with him, not by sitting and taking a lesson, just by doing it in the trenches. And in the trenches is where you make changes and where things happen. And so I spent a lot of trench time with Jim, and we've remained friends all these years. Before we get started here, I want to mention one other thing for your thinking, which is 48 years ago yesterday, Martin Luther King was assassinated. And I didn't read much of that, but that's an important milestone date in the history of our country, at a time it was really, really tough. And it's worth thinking about what he stood for. A lot of the change we talk about happening in Montana was part of a larger fabric of change across this country, of which he was a major part of. And of course, it wasn't but 2 months and one more day while Bobby Kennedy was killed. And so when we talk about individual people shaping history, if you think of Bobby Kennedy, you think of Martin Luther King, you think those are people that probably did shape history more than history shaped them. And I like to think about Jim that way, too. I think from when it comes to Montana, he really helped shape history. So, Jim,
well,
let's talk
you.
A little bit about how you got started in this labor movement and then what really the importance of labor all the way around.
Well, I really appreciate all those kind words, but I think you should explain that you just made that stuff up to get people to come to the class. And I thought maybe what we could do is just put this stuff aside. If Pat Williams is going to be here, we could talk about Pat Williams, because I can think of a lot of stories to tell about him. And maybe we could come up with some questions that could be asked of him when he comes as a guest. Yeah. That would be better than anything I have. I want to straighten out a record here, the record in Butte. I've spent a lot of time here through my life, and great times. Some maybe not so great by most people's standards, but by mine, they were always great. I love this community. If your name is Jim Murry, people, and you're a labor guy, then everybody just automatically assumes that you're from Butte or Anaconda. And I've been trying to explain all my life that I'm not from Butte or Anaconda. I'm a Laurel guy. I grew up on the south side right behind the refinery. great blue-collar community. But the other part of the record that I want to straighten out is that a lot of years ago, Katie Murry was a local county official here in Butte. And Katie spelled her name M-U-R-R-A-Y. Mine is without the A. It's just as Irish. But I could always tell if I was in trouble in Butte, because if I was really doing well, she would always call me cousin. And if she wasn't calling me cousin, I really had to kind of look out, because I was going to have some difficulty somewhere along the line while I was here. So through all of these years, there are so many people, and there's two young ladies in this room that were talking about me being a cousin of Katie Murray's, Lebanese, and from here in Butte. Well, if I were from Butte, I'd be so proud of that, I'll tell you. I'm not from Butte, I'm not from Anaconda, I'm not Lebanese, I'm Irish. And so is there somewhere, I don't know where this
should
message
we put up,
can
should
go.
Should we put up a plaque?
I was telling the story about some of you remember Jackie Corr, and Jackie was like Evan, he was very opinionated. And Jackie, I was over here at a book festival, as a matter of fact, and Jackie was telling people about my ethnicity. And I said, Jackie, I'm not Lebanese, I'm Irish. And he argued with me.
Yeah.
And as I told both of you, I lost the argument. I finally just gave up. But anyhow, I wanted to straighten that out. Evan, I really appreciate the opportunity to be here, and thank you for this, for the kind invitation. I do. I really appreciate it. I grew up in Laurel. My dad organized the local union and the refinery where I worked for 10 years down there. So I grew up in a union household. When I was 15, I joined the laborers union, worked on construction jobs in the summer, just like any man. I got the full wage, the laborer's wage. I was a good hand, and I was proud of that. I was proud of my union membership. But that was just something that I grew up with from the time I was just a little kid. The discussions around the dinner table were usually about politics and about things that were going on with the union and my dad's activities there. So I tell people I really didn't have much of a chance in life to do anything but what I ended up doing. As a confession, I'll tell you, I went to college and I was going to get a degree in business. You probably didn't know that. And I was going to get a degree in business, and I was not going to live like my mom and dad did for so many years, because it took so much commitment, and they gave so much of their lives to the labor movement, being active politically, influencing what went on politically and all of that. And I said, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to do something different. Well, I got 14 credits into my senior year. First, I got kicked out. Arlene and I responded to that. I got kicked out of college, and we responded by getting married, which was kind of a disappointment to her folks. And my what really hurt my feelings about that is my mother always used to say that Arlene could have done so much better than she did. And I really had to work to kind of redeem myself, because she felt very strongly about that and would be quite a source of embarrassment when she would bring that up with people, because she wasn't shy about talking about how Arlene could have done so much better than she did marrying me. But we got married. I was following pipeline construction work at that time. We boomed around the country, lived in Ohio. A couple of our oldest kids were born there. And we lived a kind of a vagabond existence for a while. Came back, and I was always a member of a union, always worked union jobs. Came back to Laurel, went back to school at Eastern, worked at night, going to school during the day. I was going to get a degree in business, and even went back to St. Paul, Minnesota, to the company headquarters, and did an interview there. I don't want to discredit anybody that took another track in their lives, but I remember I did this interview, and when we got back to the motel, I told Arlene, I said, this isn't going to work. She said, what do you mean it isn't going to work? And I said, I'm just not going to fit in this environment, trying to get my socks to match my eyes. And I used to drink quite a bit in those days, and I know that I'd be in all kinds of trouble going to company receptions and things like that. I'd be getting in arguments with people and tipping the tables over. That's what you did in Laurel, and that wasn't going to work. And so I ended up quitting school. We went back to Billings after my interview, back to Laurel, and I became active in my local union. And
At the refinery.
I became active politically first. My dad had organized the Laurel Democratic Club, and they needed a president real bad, and no one wanted the job. And so they drafted me. Chet Blylock had a lot to do with that, and made me ashamed that I hadn't made much of a contribution to anything. And so I agreed that I would give that a try. And I was going to be the best president of the Laurel Democratic Club ever had, and show them that I could really do a good job with that. And then I was just going to show them that, and I was going to walk away and not do that anymore. I'd still pretty well made up my mind that I wasn't going to spend my life like my dad had spent his. Well, it's such an addictive kind of a thing, I was overcome with it. And I ended up becoming president of my local union for a very short time. And then I was asked to become the political director for the Montana State AFL-CIO in 1966. And that's when Arlene and I moved to Helena to start this, to begin this journey.
Now that's the big year when Lee Metcalf was running for re-election, and he was being opposed by the sitting governor.
Tim Babcock. Tim Babcock was a very personable guy too. He was a great candidate, because he had a tremendous military record, an outgoing personality, very congenial with people. By my standards, very conservative. I had worked to try to do everything I could to defeat him when he was running for the legislature in Yellowstone County. He ended up being in the governor's office and challenged Lee in 1966, and that was going to be a tough campaign. That was going to be a hard campaign, and it was Lee Metcalf was just he was the greatest guy in the world to work with and to be around. He was such a supporter of little people. He was a real people person. He understood the things that we understood probably better at that time than is perhaps the case now. But we were talking about the 66 campaign and Lee Metcalf. And Lee Metcalf really...
We're talking about what the coalition's...
And Lee really understood the coalition approach to politics. And so he was a real stalwart with the Farm Labor Coalition. He was a reason that the Old People's Voice came into existence, and it was we can talk about that later with liberal publication published in Helena, because we weren't getting our story across with the Anaconda-controlled newspapers, and so the Old People's Voice came into existence. Lee Metcalf understood all of that, and he was a player in all of it. And so I came on pretty much of a kid at that time, and came to Helena and had the experience of being able to work really closely in that campaign, and it was just a tremendous experience. Lee had so many attributes. He was a great conservationist. Anybody that's interested in the conservation movement, he's a saint. He was one of the most highly supported union candidates in the United States Senate or in the Congress of the United States. He was always with workers, and understood workers, and not only did he just vote right on issues, he carried so many of those important issues to workers. So I got a chance to come from the south side of Laurel, Montana, to come to Helena, and it was really quite an experience to do something like
that. During that campaign, you got to deal with Gordon Bennett,
yeah,
who we've seen on film, and you got to deal with Ron Richards.
Ron Richards, yeah.
You got to deal, of course, with Lee and with all kinds of other players. Probably first started with Clyde, even then, I suppose, with the Clyde Jarvis.
No, Clyde.
Or was it Leonard Kenfield?
Leonard Kenfield was the president of the Montana Farmers Union. Tom Ryan was the secretary treasurer.
Mm-hmm.
And they were giants in the liberal movement. Farmers Union really played a critical and important role in that coalition. We went through a couple of real tough battles over right to work in 1953 and 58.
Sounds like today almost.
Yeah,
maybe we've got it coming again.
But the coalition was more meaningful in those days. And so you don't need to write this stuff down, because I'm just making it up as I'm going along.
Thank you.
But I'll be close.
All the more reason to write it down.
But the Farmers Union, had it not been for the Farmers Union, Montana would have probably become a right-to-work state in 1953 and 58. And they really played a role working with us. And they were great supporters of Lee Metcalf's. And so all of that just kind of came together. And it was really an important time in my life. And it was really a great time.
So Lee, and that was your first baptism in a risk at a state level on a state big race.
Yes, I'd worked when, you remember when Jack Toole, mm-hmm, ran for Congress, I worked in that campaign on weekends and took some time off. In fact, I almost got fired at the refinery because I was not very good about showing up for work. I was more involved with the political campaign than I was making a living, which was kind of crazy, I guess. But I worked in that, and that was a congressional campaign. I worked, mm-hmm, worked in Great Falls and some places like that. But really, in terms of putting budgets together and putting educational material together, and that to appeal statewide, that was the first time I'd done that.
And it came out okay.
Came out really okay. Really okay. That's right.
So 66. Now by 68, another big year we've talked about here, which is the year for Forrest Anderson getting elected, and that after 16 years of Republicans in the governorship was probably the biggest thing about 1968. But in between 66 and 68, you moved up a notch.
I became the executive officer for the Montana State AFL-CIO. I succeeded a guy by the name of Jim Umber, who was the first executive officer after the merger in 1953, I think.
Y'all remember, if you remember your history, the AFL-CIO, AFL, American Federation of Labor, CIO, Congress of Industrial Organizations, two separate organizations at the national level, and that merger that occurred in the early 50s created the strength of unions working together, industrial unions and essentially trade unions. And so Umber was with the state Fed from the beginning until then.
Yes. And he was, and Jim had been, prior to the merger, he had been the head of the AFL. I'm an old industrial unionist, and I came out of what was originally the old Oil Workers International Union, which was a very left of center. It was almost like the old mine mill and smelter workers, those of you that have a recollection of how they were here in Butte. The old oil workers was a lot the same, very left, a lot of old socialists were involved with that union. So there was quite a change when I became the executive secretary, because that switched from it, the federation being led by a building trades, somebody out of the building trades, by somebody out of an industrial union. And so that in itself created some problems, because in the labor, you know, the labor movement's not a monolithic kind of a group by any means at all. There's always all kinds of internal debate and disagreement and struggles, sometimes strife that goes on internally in unions and in state labor unions and international unions and the national AFL-CIO. That's just kind of the nature of our existence. But again, I came from a industrial union background. The thing, and Evan, I've said this a number of times, the thing that really attracted me to the labor movement, and no one from my local ever before me got a full-time job in the labor movement, so no one ever, I didn't think that I would ever be doing that. I was just going to stay in the refinery till I got killed or died or retired or whatever happened. A lot of people got sick and died in that. But I came from this industrial union background. That the thing that attracted me to the labor movement was that everybody, did they carry the union card or not? I was raised to believe that we should be doing everything we could to support them. So it was really easy for me to get involved in things like minimum wage fights, and think we first minimum wage law was passed during this period that we're looking at. But the kind of legislation that affected not only union members, but we reached out every worker to everybody in the community. When we fought for unemployment comp laws and changes in the laws and workers' comp and industrial safety and all of those kind of things, we didn't go to the legislature and make the case that we just want these protections. We made the case that we wanted these protections and those benefits for every worker in Montana. That, being an industrial unionist, really felt a strong tie to this need to fight to bring about needed social change, civil rights movement and things like that. I always ended up very involved in all of that kind of activity because of my background. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I was in conflict. Sometimes there were people in the Montana labor movement that thought maybe I was too extreme, and we had differences.
And then you had to work them out. Now,
and we had to
now,
work them out.
Now, in this, the legislature in 67, following that 66 election, Lee was elected, and then suddenly you're dealing with the legislature, and that was the roots of a lot of interesting thing because of that sales tax that Felt and Babcock put together. and that led to some challenges in 68. I wonder if you could kind of discuss that.
Well, that was a challenge. The tax issue was really a challenge, but Evan, the other thing that was so tough for workers at that time, we had some of the poorest, stingiest worker protection laws, workers' comp, unemployment comp. We didn't have a minimum wage law. We didn't have collective bargaining for teachers. We didn't have collective bargaining for public employees and all of that. We didn't have those benefits. Mm-hmm. And so as we went into that period that you're talking about, we were looking and fighting real hard over tax legislation and sales tax because it was so unfair. But we were just working night and day. What we did is we worked so hard to help elect people to the state legislature that would be sympathetic to the needs of little people all across the state. And we had significant success with that. So that and what went on in local communities with community-based organizations, there was a progressive political tone that was established all over the state that helped with what we were trying to do in those days in the legislature. There's a lot of that that's kind of missing now.
Mm-hmm. And now in that legislature, the Republicans had the House, and Felt was, you knew, but Felt was the Speaker. And he was advancing that bill on the sales tax, and they jammed it through. But then it went over to the Senate, where clearly you'd been successful in having a Democratic Senate. And what happened to it there? And because that helped shape with a lot of things in 68.
Let me tell you a story about Jim Felt. Is there anybody here that's related? Do any of you know Jim Felt? You remember Jim Felt? He was a Republican from Billings, and a pretty conservative guy. And he roomed with Skeff Sheehy in law school, and he was a Catholic, and he ran for lieutenant governor, mm-hmm. and in Billings I don't tell this story to disparage anybody, but in Billings there was a lot of the influence in Yellowstone County was with the Masonic organizations, and Jim Felt was very loyal to Tim Babcock, who was part of that Masonic group in Yellowstone County. I just love to tell the story, but Felt and I became friends. And the thing that we had in common more than anything else is we both drank quite a bit. He didn't vote with us very often, and I could argue with him. I used to really make him feel bad about what they did to him when he ran for lieutenant governor, and they beat him so badly. I'd just drive him up the wall. He was the speaker during that session. He was the speaker in 67.
Yeah.
And he and Jim Lucas decided they wanted to bring all these union guys into a meeting at the Capitol. And they wanted to answer all of our questions about right to work, or about sales tax, excuse me, about the sales tax. Well, the thing that was pretty clear to me is that...
And they were pretty persuasive guys.
They were very persuasive. And they had outgoing personalities. I mean, they were nice guys. But the thing that was really clear to me that the union guys were probably not going to be able to carry on a tough discussion about the issue of the sales tax, because these guys were going to gang up on them, whoever would ask the question,
very schooled on the issue.
That's right. So we went into the meeting, and they did the discussion, and geez, they really put together some good stuff. I told the guys and some of the gals, we had some gals too, when we went in, I said, now when they open it to questions, don't anybody say a word. Don't ask any questions. Just sit there. Don't ask any questions. So they got done with their presentation, and they said, you know, big smile. Are there any questions? Gosh, Jim, it's good to see you. Good to see so-and-so and doing all that. And are there any questions? And everybody just sit there. And Jim Lucas was a, geez, he was a really an articulate guy. He was kind of a hero of mine. He was a baseball player and used to pitch for the Laurel baseball team when I was playing Legion ball. And so he was kind of a hero of mine. And I it was kind of a letdown as I got older. I found out I couldn't be very supportive for my hero with anything but his athletic skills. But I'll never, he was just practically begging people to ask questions. I'll never forget that. And so finally they just gave up. And when we went out, I'll never forget, Jim Felt said to me, he said, "That is the worst thing you have ever done."
Yeah, not a chance to persuade
but,
him.
Yeah, but those kind of things get to be pretty important. You better be creative and imaginative as you deal with those issues, or you're gonna end up in a lot of trouble. But that's one of my great memories.
Well, talk a little bit about Gene Mahoney in '67, and then Gene Mahoney in '68, because I think that made a difference in some of the things you did over the years.
I'm not so sure I like the idea of this being filmed.
The face on the cutting room floor.
Is there any attorneys here that I don't? I'd like to know about the statute of limitations.
I think it's over.
Gene Mahoney was the Senate Majority Leader. He was an Anaconda guy, by the way. His dad was a cop over there, and I remember things like this. I don't remember important things, but they called him Second Gear Mike Mahoney because he always drove his car around down in second gear. Just call him Second Gear. Well, Gene was an attorney, lived over in Thompson Falls, and had a really distinguished career in the legislature. Ended up, at that time, was the Senate Majority Leader, and was really, really a good friend of workers. Carried a lot of our legislation, made the fight on just all kinds of issues. In those days, the environmental battles were starting, and we were very supportive of the environmental movement, what became the environmental movement. He was one of those people that was really outspoken about the need to do something about the TP burners in the areas where the timber industry was so strong. But he was really one of our best friends. Gene, in 1968, Gene ran for the governorship against Forrest Anderson.
Democratic primary.
And Forrest Anderson had been a good friend, but some of us thought that he was too close to the companies like the Montana Power Company. I harbored some of those feelings myself, by the way, I talked to him about that extensively, and he'd shout at me once in a while about his feelings about it, but we were friends. But in that election campaign, we went with Gene Mahoney, and we didn't have any money. Mahoney didn't have any money, and we did it essentially with just boots on the ground organization. I don't remember. Do you remember what the spread was in that?
About 2,400 votes, about 39,000 to 37,000.
It was really tight. And the thing about that, I always remember, Forrest called me after, the day after the election. He asked me if I'd have coffee with him. I said, sure. So we met at the 4Bs, and we sat down. He was a great guy. He was like a little bandy rooster. God, he was just aggressive as hell and really intimidating. He was an attorney, very bright, very articulate, and just could be just
5'4".
I don't think he was that tall, was he? He was, and could be saltier in hell. I mean, he could have worked underground here in Butte. So I went to the 4Bs and I sat down with him, and it was kind of you could feel the tension in the air. And Forrest looked at me and he said, "Well," he said, "I told you I was going to kick your ass, didn't I?" And I said, "Yeah, you did. That's what you said." I said, "But you didn't get it done nearly as well as you would have liked to have." "Well, no," but he said, "I kicked your ass nevertheless. I said, "That's right." He said, "So now what are you going to do?" And I said, we're gonna be the strongest supporters that you have in this election. We're gonna have the best door-to-door voter registration, get out the vote, political education program in America by the labor movement. Best one ever. He said, "Do you mean that?" I said, "Forrest, I don't say things that I don't mean." And he was really surprised. And we did that. It's exactly what we did. And
I mentioned before to the class that Forrest practiced the politics of inclusion instead of taking people that were against him and saying, "To hell with you," as some people do. He said, "Can you be with me? And if you can be with me, you're welcome." And a lot of good, talented folks came into the fold because he was inclusive.
And that's really a good point. What people in, geez, I almost sound like I'm some kind of an authority, and I'm not. I've been out of the loop for so long, but I think I'm right about this. The rest of the stuff I might be wrong about. People in political office, especially in governor's offices, there's a tendency of them to kind of suck up and be in a tight little bubble. And there's people in the bubble that governors are comfortable talking with, confiding in, and they're protected by the people in that bubble. But that's the worst instinct in the world, because the proper instinct, is to grow that bubble as much as possible. And in doing that, people in public office will recognize that there are some people that they can, they'll have a closer relationship with than others. They can confide more in some of those folks than others. But you've got to always be expanding that bubble. And that's exactly what we did with the coalition effort in Montana. We were always growing the bubble. We were making that bubble bigger. And we wanted people to come in that bubble, even if they didn't like us. We wanted them to be with us. I had an image of being pretty strident and
no.
And looking back, I think I might have been able to avoid some of that had I been a little older and a little more mature. But one of the things that I used to do, I used to be invited to chamber meetings all over the state to speak. And God, they'd be waiting for me. They'd just be waiting for me. But I would always do that enthusiastically, because I wanted to get out. I wanted to hear what the business community was saying. And once in a while, we would find people there that we could work with, that we could have a good relationship with. They would sometimes become involved in things that we were doing in the community and political campaigns, and maybe putting together some programs with the city central bodies and in those local communities because of people that we would find that way. But what the concentration was always on expanding that bubble, growing that bubble, and Forrest Anderson, Forrest really did understand that. But Lee Metcalf was like that too. Lee mm-hmm. Metcalf was very much. Arnold Olson was like that. I think most people in political office, if they're around very long, they learn to do that, or they're not around.
Mm-hmm.
Not around long.
No, you got to get that 50% plus one.
That's right. That's right.
Well, then, with Forrest getting elected in '68, pay more what for?
Yeah.
Who came up with that slogan?
Did Harry do that, or who was it?
It was one of your buddies from Laurel.
who was it?
Jim.
Oh, Jim Graff. That's right. It was Jim Graff. Yeah, I forgot about that.
He was working with Sage Advertising.
And he and I played ball together in Laurel. He was a couple of years
old. Now, one thing you learn is that anybody that's anybody important in the state of Montana is somehow connected to Laurel, according to Jim.
tell the story about Dodie Colbert.
So Jim is always talking about how Dodie Colbert is from Laurel.
she was superintendent of public instruction.
Yeah, she was in the film on education with Dan Harrington.
And she was a great commissioner of political practices.
And, Jim was commissioner of political practices for a couple of years here, about a year a while back under an appointment from Governor Schweitzer. So they were both COPP cops. But Jim kept saying, well, when you see Doty, say hi, because she's from Laurel. And so when Doty came in, I said, Doty, I said, Jimmy Murry says to tell you hello, and he really, because you're from Laurel. And she says that, Murry. She says, everybody's from Laurel when it comes to Murry. She says, I was born in Big Timber, and I was raised in Billings. She said, and I went to Laurel High School for 1 year, for Christ's sake. She said, but Jim will never let go. He keeps saying I'm from Laurel. So
well, she had a pretty distinguished record,
yeah,
so I thought we'd ought to adopt her. Yeah, I am inclined to be that way. I sure agree with that.
Now, that 68 was a tough year because things were coming along pretty well. Arnold kept his seat, though he lost it 2 years after that. We got the governorship for the first time. But at a national level, you had to deal with the national issue.
Oh, boy.
And that was such a divisive year because of Lyndon Johnson stepping out, and McCarthy and Bobby Kennedy, and then Hubert Humphrey coming in, and the national convention was such a disaster. And so when it was all said and done, it was really a hard race to run in the fall for Humphrey.
Oh, boy, it sure was.
And it set some seeds for future problems as well, but your reflections on the divisiveness that occurred at the national level that impacted the state level.
Well, and I was a delegate to that 68 Democratic Convention in Chicago. That was really quite an experience. We had National Guard with us all the time, had guards on the overpasses, armed people on the overpasses in Chicago. When they'd take us from the hotel out to the convention center out there, that was a...
The riots were later referred to as police riots, actually, officially, because it turned out the excess was on the side of the police and Mayor Daley, but nonetheless.
And by the way, just so you know, I'm as loyal to Chicago and the Daley family as I am to Butte and the people over here. I really have great feelings of loyalty to Chicago. It's a great city. It's my favorite big city in the world, really. But that convention was really something. And we went into the convention after having a difficult state convention, and so there was a real split between the people that were the
Kennedy people
and the Gene McCarthy people.
Gene McCarthy people. I was a McCarthy guy.
Evan was a McCarthy guy. And I was always a Hubert Humphrey guy. We got to that convention, and
Forrest Hotel.
We got to the national convention. Oh. Forrest went with us,
yeah.
And on our standard, we had no sales tax in Montana. Pay more what for that placard that we had, but there was some hard feelings there because there was in those conventions emotions. State conventions, national conventions, emotions run very high. And there were some of the folks, frankly, that was on the same side I was on here in Helena, or in the convention was in Helena, and there was some bad feelings about the way people were treated. And looking back on that, I didn't blame them for feeling bad at all. That led to some of the dramatic rules changes mm-hmm. that came after that. And mm-hmm. then we went into the convention where George McGovern was the standard bearer, and so we had a lot of internal problems in the progressive community and in the Democratic Party as those rules were coming together and as changes were being made.
Let's come back to that because that's a natural place to go. But we had an intervening thing that after the 69 session, which they didn't bring a sales tax up because they'd been beaten so badly in 68, and they ended up, Forrest got his reorganization and the CONCON on the ballot and so on and so forth, but suddenly there was an open congressional seat in eastern Montana.
That's right.
That Batten was appointed by Nixon, to be a federal judge, and suddenly that Republican seat in eastern Montana was open. And so tell us what happened in 69.
Well, that was, boy, and that was another year, wasn't it? That we had a special election that year for the...
June of 69, right after the legislature.
We'd gone through a campaign, we'd gone through the legislature, and we're right back in another campaign. I remember that. It was just like, those of us that were active, we never had time to, with our families. I mean, literally, we were never around home on weekends or any of that. We just worked. We just worked all the time. But that's when John Melcher, was that the second?
There was a Lewistown convention to get a nomination. And he was nominated over, like, Jerry Kate and
Jack McDonald.
And McDonald and Tool.
That's right.
And he ended up running against Bill Mather.
Yeah.
From Roundup. Well, from then Billings. He was the Roundup
guy.
That's
right.
Yeah, Billings.
That's right.
And so, but here we have a special election in June. Now, you guys were a big part of that, weren't you?
Well, we just moved everything down to Billings, to where the headquarters was, for Melcher, and worked in that campaign. We worked very hard on voter registration and put together a top-notch get out the vote effort with the Democratic Party, with other organizations that we could work with at the time. But one of the things, Evan, that we really focused on, you'll remember, was absentee ballots. Mm-hmm. I don't want to tell all the stories about absentee ballots, but John Melcher won by the absentee ballots cast in that election. That's how tight that was.
And unlike Butte, you know, you had to be alive to vote. That was a tight race, but it was quite a difference. And all of a sudden, that Eastern District, so for that, at that particular moment, and we showed a picture of that during the class, as you remember, that picture that, it was different, but during that time, you had Arnold Olson, and he was still there for one more year. You had
Lee Metcalf.
Mike Mansfield, Arnold Olson, and John Melcher, all four members of the delegation, were Democratic.
Really something.
On the other hand, they just...
Who had been the congressman from that district for several years was an interesting guy. He was another guy that very close to Tim Babcock. Very much a part of that establishment in Yellowstone County that I was telling you about. A very congenial guy, really easy to talk to. Wouldn't vote with us by accident. Very, very conservative. But one of the things about that I think about that time that was pretty interesting, Evan, is that now we have this thing within the Republican Party, the Tea Party, that is really influencing the Republican Party, not only here in Montana, but all across the nation, really having an impact on the presidential election right now. Well, the predecessor to the Tea Party was the John Birch Society. And in those days, the John Birch Society had tremendous influence here in Montana. Mm-hmm. And Jim Batten and Tim Babcock were very much a part of that world. There were groups like the Young Americans for Freedom.
YAF,
remember?
Yeah.
Do you remember those groups? Mm-hmm. And they were on the executive boards for those for many. I'm trying to think of another organization that they were really involved with. But these organizations were just like or very much like the Tea Party now. They were arguing for what we felt was unfair taxation, putting more emphasis on lower income people, middle income America to be carrying the load, paying the taxes, sort of thing. They were adamant supporters of right to work and those kind of things. That was really before the environmental movement really got a start. But the point being is that, you know, we look around and I think people tend to think, gee, this is really something that the what we're watching happening here in Montana right now with the influence of the Tea Party. We went through that.
Well, it emerged. If you look at 1960, they were substantially responsible for electing Nutter.
That's right.
as governor.
And he was killed in the
plane wreck, but they also had supported Babcock, and they were very, very strong, and they're strong in western Montana. That all emerged out of the McCarthyism red-baiting stuff that was about a decade earlier. That's worth studying, is what happened in Montana.
That's really an interesting observation, that's right.
It came out of the anti-red stuff at the end of World War II, the red baiting, the red web over Congress stuff, and those folks eventually became the John Birch Society, who thought Dwight Eisenhower was a traitor. They said he was a traitor of the country.
Right.
So they were influential in Montana politics at that time, and so when Batten left, the shift to John Melcher was a big,
dramatic,
big shift.
Really dramatic shift.
Now, Farmers Union, I presume, was big in
oh, very much so. The Farmers Union was, we were both of our organizations were very involved in all the campaigns, not only at the state level, but also in legislative races, all over the state. Mm-hmm. We had regular meetings with the Farmers Union to talk about campaigns, talk about legislation. We were partners.
Mm-hmm. And so when that was done, we went through the 70 election, as I recall.
Before,
yeah,
hold your train of thought. I remember when Senator Jim Murry, no relation, he spells his name like Katie Murray, and I don't think he wasn't Lebanese either. I think
no.
Now I forgot what I was going to say. I'm really taken up with that. Boy, I'll tell you. God bless Katie.
You're talking about the Red Web and Murray.
But anyhow, I think it was probably the last time that Jim Murray ran for the Senate. They published a pamphlet that went out over the state. It was the Red Web over Montana.
Yeah.
And it had it was a Red Web over the.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, it was really.
That was 1954.
Effective.
Right at the heart of McCarthyism, because he decided not to run for re-election in 1960, which is when Lee Metcalf was elected in his place. So he ran in 54, and that was the heart of the McCarthyism period. And boy, is that so the Birch Society kind of flowed out of that, and then the next thing you know, it was part of Goldwater and all kinds of other.
That's
things.
Right. And so when Goldwater went down. Like he did, and there was really a pretty progressive tone set in America, Montana being one of the states that was more so than a lot of other places. There was that ultra-conservative movement kind of backed out of the picture. They just weren't as...
And as much as you would say that you would look at Richard Nixon as being a problematic president in a lot of ways, if you looked at him domestically, a lot of his initiatives were fairly moderate.
Oh, yeah.
Revenue sharing with the states, the Environmental Protection Agency being created. There were a lot of things that happened.
Oh, yes.
That showed that there was the right wing on the Republican side had slid down as the progressive wing of the Democratic side had swung up. And there was even progressivism with Republicans, as evidenced by the progressives that ran as Republicans for the CONCON.
Yes, yes.
But you know, in between here, let's do something real quick here, which is, the CONCON election was a special election in '71. That came along with the sales tax election, and we had the battle royale, which you were engaged in heavily for the whole '71 session about the sales tax, with Lucas. And out of that came the ballot thing. Let's talk a little bit about the legislature and maybe a little bit about the election.
Well, they were really bound and determined that they were going to enact a sales tax. I mean, boy, that was just...
Which was really for it to be a tax shift. If you had a sales tax, it allowed you to lower taxes on corporations
that's
and
right,
wealthy.
That's right. That was part of the package.
Yeah.
And that's what made it so terribly unfair.
That's what made it important to them, however, to keep
coming
back to it.
That's right. They were gonna maximize their profit by virtue of that shift in the taxes, but they were really bound and determined that they were going to have a that they were going to have a sales tax. And they did a lot of things to split people. There was some of that in the labor movement. There was, we found some of the labor organizations that weren't with us, joining with us in the opposition to the sales tax. I don't remember any of the organizations, by the way, including the MEA, were really silent as we were making that fight on sales tax. I know that.
NFT, yeah, that's right. Not in Butte.
I don't have to be reminded of that. But the MEA was one of the organizations that was quiet on that, because that was part of the fight that we had with the MEA for years, because they were willing to consider a sales tax to have more revenue for teachers and for all of that. And we said, no, let's just have a fair tax system and make money available for teachers, right? And the AFT was as strong in that support of our position as any of the affiliates in Montana. There was no question about where you guys were. But there was a lot of work being done to split the labor movement, split farmers and ranchers off on that that issue. And so we went through that hellacious battle in the legislature, and where we were able to block that effort, and then we went to the ballot issue.
There was about 120 days of the legislature, and suddenly, late June, it suddenly is put on the ballot for November.
That's right.
That was a busy period.
Can you imagine that? I mean, it was just like that. And we had a great discussion of the great part of this. Was the, do I sound like I have a kind of a bias about the Montana Power Company and the Anaconda Company? And
if I mean, this is about the copper collar being removed.
Is that okay? So I can do this?
Yes.
Okay. Well, they, as the sales tax was being promoted, the hue and cry, the mantra was that all the money that was going to support their ballot effort was coming from little old ladies, retired people, just people on Main Street that just wanted, remember the three-legged stool argument that they used to make?
That we need just, to have an income tax, a property tax, and a sales tax,
that's right. And so all the money was coming from small donations.
Dollar at a time,
yeah. Bernie Sanders, kind of a Bernie Sanders approach to a different kind of an issue. But that, they were in the press talking about this all the time on all the news sources. And if you believed what they were saying, you would conclude that, boy, this is really a
grassroots
people movement. But we found out that that wasn't the case at all. We had a friend that should we go into this?
I kind of went into it in the class, but it's important to share a little bit with this. So we did talk about the fact that we just see how we put it, keep a shorthand, that we discovered these letters from Lucas to the world of big business in Montana that said part of this
was left in the briefcase over there.
Yeah, that's what they say. Yeah, and, yes, we talked about that, but yeah. In fact, this is part of my learning with Jim Murry was, you know, remember in June, he just finishes a battle royale in the legislature, and suddenly we have a sales tax battle coming up, and I walked in and said, "Hi, I'm Evan Barrett, I'm the new executive director of the Democratic Party, can you tell me what I should be doing?" You know, essentially. And
wearing a Mickey Mouse sweatshirt with the sleeves cut out. I'm not exaggerating, and I'm looking, and I'd gone through a couple of these guys. The other guys turned out really well, by the way. But I looked and I thought, God damn, this is really it's getting tougher all the time. And I think we were wearing shorts.
Yeah, cut offs. Yeah. I was only 25. But in any case, we ended up having these letters at our hands.
I'm going home.
I'll tell you, though, that this was my learning, because I went to Jim and I said, look, remember me telling you this? Look at these letters. What do we do with them? Should we announce that we have these? And he said, No, let's hold him for a few weeks and let's challenge him to say no for about four or five more times. Let's get their neck way out there saying, oh, we don't do that. No, we didn't do this. We didn't do this. Because then it's going to be worth it. So I just did what the boss said.
And the guy that was making the arguments for us was Harry Billings, mm-hmm. who was been the... We had our organization. Theirs was SOS, Save Our State.
Right.
Ours was COST.
COST, Citizens Opposed to Sales.
And Harry was debating, a really brilliant guy, just absolutely a brilliant guy. And he was debating the issue. And so he was really helpful in engineering this approach that ended up, in the court. And with Arnold Olson was helping us with it. And God, in the final analysis, what became very clear was the money was coming from the major corporations in Montana. They weren't coming, the money wasn't coming from little old ladies and retired people and workers that were so, union workers that were so excited about it. And it just killed them.
It exploded.
And it set the stage for the election, for the CONCON election.
Well, the CONCON was on the ballot at the same time, and so when it did really blow up, and it is a long story about how it blew up, but it was on the front pages, as you recall, on the front pages of all the papers for the last 3 weeks, and it was like all of a sudden the corporate giants were in charge of everything, and everybody, and the Republicans were in bed with them like this, that Republicans just got decimated in the election.
And it destroyed Jim Lucas.
And
Jim Lucas was really, really an effective legislator and a leader for the Republicans.
70% vote against it, and 59 Democrats in the CONCON. Republicans only had 34, I think. And it set the tone for the Constitution being progressive.
That's right.
Although it seemed to be a lot of, because the Supreme Court had ruled that legislators couldn't run for the CONCON, bunch of fresh faces there which seemed to be more progressive than if it would have been the legislature. Your thoughts?
Then remember there was a discussion about how the CONCON delegates would be seated. Remember mm-hmm. that? And, you know, during the legislative session you have Republicans on the left side of the aisle, Democrats are on the right. So the discussion turned on, well, what are we going to do during the CONCON? Because there wasn't that distinction. And so the decision was they sat alphabetically.
Even though they ran by party, they sat alphabetically.
They sat alphabetically. That really set the stage, I think, for more meaningful relationships among the CONCON delegates. Did a marvelous job. That was the best document of its kind in America.
Mm-hmm. So you worked in that, and the labor worked in that, but the product was really a good product. It had to be kind of almost, but you guys were lobbying that somewhat.
Oh yeah, we were very involved.
Because they didn't want lobbyists, but it didn't matter. Lobbyists
that's
were there.
We were there, and George Heliker who was at the university. Remember George Heliker? He was president of the teachers union over there. Really a good guy. He was the chair of the CONCON labor committee,
mm-hmm.
and so I was. George asked me to come in to the committee to talk about something. I don't remember what it was, but it wasn't going to take a lot of time. And we were in the Senate chambers, and I'll never forget that. They kept me in there questioning me and testifying for almost 4 hours. I was just exhausted. But there was a delegate there from Billings by the name of Ralph Studer. And Ralph Studer ran a non-union
construction company.
What he did is he built roads and bridges and things like that. And I played, and his kids all went to school at Billings Central. And I played ball against him. His son Dean played football at Notre Dame. Mm-hmm. A tremendous remember? A tremendous athlete. Well, Ralph was, God, was he conservative. And they were just beating the crap out of me and asking questions about everything. I mean, stuff that didn't apply to the what they were discussing at the ConCon at all. And George Heliker just let that go. And I never forget, Ralph Suter raised his hand. I said, yes, Mr. Suter. He said, Mr. Murry, said, where did you get your legal training? And I said, what? Well, what do you mean? He said, your legal background. He said, you're an attorney, aren't you? And I said, no, as a matter of fact, I'm not an attorney. He said, well, where did you get your legal background? And I said, Mr. Suter, I got all of my legal training in Sonny O'Day's bar in Laurel. And Chet Blalock, everybody laughed so hard, and Chet Blalock read that into the minutes of the ConCon itself because he wanted that recorded for posterity. He thought that was so good. I told George Heliker, I said, George, I'm not going to come back and go through that again. He said, well, yes. He said, I think you will. And I said, I'm not going to. He said, well, we do have subpoena power, you know. And I said, George, you wouldn't subpoena me to come before that. And he said, well, we might if we want you to come and answer some questions. But, so it was some really interesting times then.
Now, we bridged right away after the ConCon to, that. You know, just in fact, before the ConCon happened, Forrest announced he wasn't going to run again. Between the election and the ConCon itself, he wasn't going to run again. And wasn't it then, or maybe it was early in January or so, but suddenly our one-term Democratic governor we suddenly had a race on our hands.
Well,
for
we
governor.
Sure did. Yes, we did.
And a division between Tom Judge, who was lieutenant governor, and Dick DeZivi, who had fought the sales tax in the Senate. We were just talking about that the other day.
Yeah, and that's, you know, that's interesting. Do many of you remember Dick DeZivi from Great Falls? He was a very prominent legislator, Democrat, a good friend of Bob Woodall's, was kind of the downside on all of that. But anyhow, his dad, I don't know if you remember this, was an international representative for the Operating Engineers Union, mm-hmm. International Union. And so Dick had this background, trade union background, like so many of us had.
But Tom Judge beats him pretty handily in the primary.
Yes,
because
yes.
Judge ran statewide and DeZivi was a legislator, you know, and that usually makes a difference. It's kind of like...
As I remember, I don't think Dick got much of a campaign together.
No.
Isn't that right?
Yeah. Well, I don't know about that, but I know the results were like he didn't have much together. You know? And Tom ran against Ed Smith for the general.
Big Ed Smith.
And suddenly Tom was governor. And that seemed to be a time when things really blossomed in terms of him taking things forward from what Forrest was doing. Everything was good with Forrest, but Forrest was, it was well pointed out by someone, that Forrest was pointed inward to getting the government to work, and Tom was pointing outward to see how it affected
the
people.
And Tom was really growing that bubble that we're talking about, mm-hmm. and trying to please people all over the state in a legislative sense. Mm-hmm. Forrest didn't do that quite like Tom did. But Forrest finished what he wanted to do,
yep.
with executive reorganization, and that was a gargantuan task. I mean,
the state couldn't have modernized without it because the Anaconda Company succeeded partially because it had a government that didn't work.
That's right. And the governor didn't have anything to do. The governor didn't have that much to do. Forrest used to talk about that. So the point being that Forrest really got, although we didn't support him in that primary that we were talking about earlier, Forrest really got a lot done. During his that one term, and I was sad when he announced that he wasn't going to run again for health reasons. He had had some real problems that he had to deal with, and Forrest was a good friend. So we went through the campaign, and Tom Judge was elected governor, and we really did.
There's a huge amount of continuity, though. The people that you'd gotten to work with Forrest, 75% of them probably
went
stayed
over.
On.
Yes, that's right.
So we had that was that coalition stuff too.
That's right. and we had a, and Tom Judge understood the coalition, and he understood the role of the Farmers Union and the AFL-CIO and all of that, and courted us. And we had a good relationship with him. But boy, there was just an explosion of legislation when you look back at that. In a union sense, teachers got the right to collectively bargain in 1971. Is that right?
Could have been, but we were collective bargaining in Butte.
Well, I know that.
But we always do it in Butte differently.
But by law, all we had was meet and confer. By law, the
public
all employers
sector bargaining, yeah.
Yeah, all employers had to do was just meet and confer. So in 71, we got collective bargaining for teachers, and then in 73, we got collective bargaining for public employees, and we were one of the first states in the nation to expand those collective bargaining rights for teachers and nurses were before that. Mary Munger headed, that's right. And
what about unemployment comp?
But our unemployment comp law was one of the worst in the nation. We ranked with Mississippi and Oklahoma and states like that. Our workers' comp law was...
So as you worked through the 70s, did you get the unemployment comp fixed quite a bit?
Oh, yeah. We made major changes in that. And we ended up with a major, during that period, reorganization of the workers' comp system, and put in place a workers' comp judge, Bill Hunt being the first workers' comp judge, you'll remember.
And we talked quite a bit about that, because the roots of, and part of that was rooted in just the traditional bad system, and part of it was result of that scandal that had political ramifications. But the reforms were reforms, and they
that's
were solid
right.
reforms that helped the position of workers substantially.
Oh, tremendously. And Montana always had this this horrible industrial accident
record.
Yeah. The number of industrial accidents, injuries, and deaths was we were always in the top states in the nation. It was really bad. When I was working at the refinery in Laurel, one of the last things that I worked on, it's been a long time ago, was a retirement bill, or it was a retirement provision in our contract. And I'll never forget that. There was a guy that was my vice president on the workers' committee. In the negotiations, the company wasn't resisting what we were talking about. And I said, you know, I'm not very smart, but there's something wrong here, because our calculations are wrong, because it's not costing them as much as we thought it was. So my friend, who was a Republican, by the way, that was kind of unusual, because in Laurel we only had three. his son is now on the Public Service Commission, by the way, Bushman.
Bushman.
Yeah, and he's a Republican from Billings. Ran for the Senate. The kid ran for the Senate too. Anyhow, families are like that, I guess. But my friend pointed out, he'd done some research and pointed out that no one in the refinery didn't retire. We died, or we got killed on the job. We didn't retire there. I'll never forget that. And what happens when you work in that kind of a circumstance or environment, it's really easy to be in denial about it. You just don't pay attention to it. And so
pension issues weren't a big issue.
No, well, it was, I
wouldn't thought they were.
I thought they were, but we weren't, you know, it was, isn't that something in my lifetime to go through an experience like that? We later had the passage of the Occupational Safety and Health Act that Lee Metcalf and those folks were so very supportive of, and then some pretty dramatic changes were made as far as industrial safety, but we still have a terrible, terrible safety record with industry in Montana. And the industry response to that, by the way, a workers' comp was not put together to serve workers. It wasn't worker legislation. What it was, the Anaconda put it together, a company put it together, and it was to limit their liability. They didn't want us going to the courts and suing and that kind of thing because we'd owned all the businesses in the states. That's how workers' comp came into existence.
And they kept silicosis off the...
That's right.
And it was paid... Silicosis benefits were paid for by the general public.
That's right.
They were not part of workers' comp. So if you were going to die of silicosis or black lung, if you were a coal miner, you were a ward of the state, and the taxpayers paid for it,
and
not
the
insurance system.
And the lobbyist testimony was Glenn Carney. Remember Glenn?
Yeah.
Lobbied for the Anaconda company. The testimony was all of those guys smoke, and the problems with their lungs. Disregard the silica in their lungs and all of that, but their problems came because they were all heavy smokers. They all drank a lot, and they were heavy smokers.
Yeah.
That's right.
Now,
but the way the workers' comp system is set up is so that the law should be. In fact, there was a preamble to our law on both the workers under workers' comp and the unemployment comp. That the law should be interpreted liberally for workers. The workplace of the workers' comp premium is based on the experience that an employer has. If an employer has a bad record, if a lot of his workers are injured, killed, made sick, and so forth, his premiums are supposed to be higher than anyone else's. In other words, it costs a lot. It's under the system. It's supposed to cost a lot to kill workers, make them sick, and cripple them. Makes sense. But what happens in the legislature, and we've just gone through that, and the Montana law is getting back to where it used to be, sadly. But so what the companies would traditionally and consistently work on would be to change the definition of injury so that you just couldn't qualify, for the benefits, made it very difficult to qualify for the benefits, and then chisel on the benefits all the time. That was just a constant battle that went
now,
on.
Now, having succeeded in actually changing workers' comp and changing unemployment comp as an example was a significant progressive advancement. But just think of having those preambles, what it took to have language that said liberally construed, spoke to the strength of the involvement of labor and the coalition, progressive coalition. To just get that language in there is...
Oh, it was amazing. Yeah, it was amazing. But the companies finally said, okay, we'll go for that. But then what we'll do is we'll change the definition of injury, change what people have to do to qualify for the benefits and so forth. So it could be liberally construed, but with conservative
definitions.
Yeah. But our law, and during that period, our workers' comp law became one of the top three or four in the nation. It was the coverage was wonderful.
Let's go back to one thing about 72, which was Lee Metcalf was up and didn't really want to run because his health wasn't well. Now, it's hard to believe that Lee died when he was about 66 or 67.
Yeah, that I just...
And so that meant he was around 60 in 1972, and he was feeling terrible and didn't want to... Let's talk a little bit about why you and workers in the progressive movement in total, women, environmental groups such as they were at the time, the fledgling environmental groups, labor, the Farm Labor Coalition, all wanted Lee to run because he was Lee.
Yeah, and he had been such a champion for all of the causes that we felt so strongly about. He was just absolutely a champion. The last time he ran, and I had
72.
I really had some misgivings about my role in that. I'll never forget. We were up in Great Falls.
Mm-hmm.
He and Donna asked. A friend of mine at the time, we later kind of split our Coalition.
McCoy, yeah.
Yeah, we asked us to come up to their room because they wanted to talk to us. Well, what Lee was going to tell us was that he was going to announce that night at the banquet that he wasn't going to run. And I never forget that.
By the way, I had an assignment that night because he thought Jim and McCoy would beat up on him a lot about running. And so he asked the chairman of the Democratic Party, Bob Sanders, to come to the meeting too.
That's right.
And you went up to me and you said, you know, we're not going to be able to talk frankly to Lee with Bob Sanders there, because Bob was not a real confidant of labor. He was a really fresh, young, not young,
he was a hell of
fresh,
a basketball
great
player
guy, great
from,
guy.
From Harden.
Great guy, but he really didn't, he was pretty naive politically, and he certainly was not, and he was going to be a buffer against you guys. So Jim says, here's the deal. He says, I don't care what you do, but you got to keep Saunders busy so he can't come to that meeting. Now, I'm the executive director of the party, and I've got the chairman there, and I'm supposed to, like, tie him up somehow and keep him from going to the meeting.
And you were pretty much of a
Which,
kid.
By the way, we did, and I was brand new on the job, and he was the chairman, but you held the meeting without him.
And Lee wanted to tell us that he wasn't going to run. And we wouldn't let him, essentially, we just wouldn't let him tell us that. And I really put it on him about how important it was that he run again. And I've often thought, if I had it to do over again, I might have done that a lot differently. Because if he had just come home and retired, maybe he would have.
He didn't serve out the term. He served about 5 years and died in office.
Died in office, remember?
At a very young age, as we see it now, you know.
Yeah. And at that night at the banquet, when he spoke,
700 people at the Roma Rainbow Hotel trying to figure out what's Lee going to do.
But the consensus was that he was not going to run. Remember that?
Mm-hmm.
And he had a speech that was written that could go either way.
Two endings.
That's right. But the speech was kind of disjointed because of what he was talking about, remember?
Yeah.
And then announced he was going to run again, and holy mackerel. Yeah. People were falling out of their chairs, including me. It was a
tough race, though. He always had tough races.
Yes, he did.
And he ran against Hank Hibbard and got, who was Max Baucus's uncle, right?
That's right.
Was a state senator, and he won by less than 10,000 votes. We know that because Jack Condon a lot. But that was another story. We won't get into that.
because we used to always make bets on the outcome of the elections. Sometimes we didn't do it.
But Lee was there then for the rest of the until he passed away. But it was a tough race, but it kept a strong coalition together.
It kept the coalition together. Are we going to, what time are you going to break up?
We have 15 minutes.
I would really like to throw this open to question there, but there might be, I'd just take a minute and talk about when, for a little bit about the convention down in Miami when George McGovern was the became the presidential standard bearer.
Mm-hmm.
What year was that?
72. That was the result of the 68. In 68, all the party regulars kicked the ass of the reformers like me and took all the delegate seats, and then the rules were rewritten, only the regulars didn't figure it out, and they wanted to keep them just like it was, you know, and they, so guess what? The next time the reformers got all the delegates and the
And they got even, didn't they?
They did. And I became executive director in the meantime, so I was a middle, I was between all of them by that time, but it was a very intriguing thing to watch what happened in Miami Beach.
We went to the state convention here.
This is a very important Lee Metcalf story, and it relates to the issue you hear about today, about people with Bernie Sanders talking about what about these superdelegates.
And the intensity that goes with all of that. Well, we had the convention, and all of a sudden, yours truly, who was kind of grew up the old left of center liberal in Montana politics, I was on the other side.
You're the conservative.
I was the conservative, and I wasn't handling it very well. I threatened to kill Tom Tao, some things like that, lost my
temper. I had to separate you a few times.
And by the way, Tom Tao was a really good friend, had a great labor voting record. We just disagreed about that convention was all. They even ran an Indian kid.
From Wolf Point.
From Wolf Point against me by the name of Jim Murry. And he won, I lost. So that was the kind of stuff that it was really an intense convention.
But what happened, one of the things that happened was Lee Metcalf was running for re-election and he wanted to go to the convention. So when you think about superdelegates, part of it came
to
out
the
of
the national
thing,
convention.
To the national convention. And he wanted to support his friend Muskie, who was already out of it by then. They were close friends. Muskie had already had the Canuck letter issue that had happened. He'd cried in public. In those days, you didn't cry in public if you were running for office. He was then out of it, but Lee was loyal to Muskie, and he wanted to go and vote for Muskie, and he had his Brit call and say, can you negotiate with the McGovern people so they would put Lee on their slate so that he can get elected to the national convention? And I said, yeah. And so I went to them and asked for Lee to be on their slate, because he was on the other slate, or two slates, you know. And the answer came back, no. And they had the votes, and guess what? Sitting U.S. senator was defeated.
And one of the greatest liberals in the history of the world. I mean, no question about that. And Lee Metcalf, I was in good company.
Yeah. You went to the convention. Lee said, forget about it. And but by the way, that was the roots of superdelegates, was people like Lee Metcalf having to, one, run against party regulars and maybe face the embarrassment of defeat, or people like state chairs and so on actually having to take seats that could go to grassroots people. So a balance was struck later, saying let's have a certain number of seats that go to party leadership and senators and governors, and then let's have the rest of it all be from the elections and the caucuses. And that's the roots of what we have now, which is not a real evil cabal. There was some necessity in it. That being said, you know what I often say, you know, yesterday's problem is our solution is today's problem. And that's good evidence. They're now saying, oh, it's a big problem, superdelegates. But it was really tough.
And that was the convention in Miami that George McGovern was selected to be the standard bearer for the Democratic Party.
Now, out of that, there was a big challenge, because nationally, the AFL-CIO decided not to endorse, and they didn't endorse Nixon, they didn't endorse McGovern.
About 14 international unions did endorse Richard Nixon. Primarily the building trades, more conservative building trades organizations.
And so at the national level, they didn't endorse, and they told the state affiliates not to endorse, and Colorado went and did an endorsement, and what happened?
They went under, the state federation went under trusteeship. Texas, my friend down there that headed up the Texas AFL-CIO announced his personal support for McGovern. He was defeated in his election. They ran him out. There were some other states around where it was really
impossible for you to follow your progressive instincts and help McGovern and survive, wasn't it?
Well, I really wasn't a McGovern
right.
fan. But when I'll never forget when we came back to Montana, I got off the plane in Helena, and Art Hutchison, a good friend with Lee Newspapers at the time, was there, and he said, Jim, are you going to support Richard Nixon? And I said, you know goddamn well I'm not going to be supporting Richard Nixon. And that quote was in the paper, by the way.
And what picked, we picked up by Time Magazine.
That was even worse. That was even worse. So what we did is we essentially ran the McGovern campaign after all of this opposition to George McGovern from the labor movement. We ran that campaign out of our office. The state coordinator for George McGovern at the time went on a vacation, went to Hawaii. He was gone. And so we ran that campaign out of our office.
But not under your banner.
But not, well, it was pretty clear what was going on.
Officially.
Then we went into our convention, and there were you know, people there saying that the emphasis was on, more than anything else, was keeping the coalition together in Montana that was so successful during those years. The women's groups, the environmental groups, labor, family farmers and ranchers, poor people, Indian organizations, and all of those, we had to keep that coalition together. And so, I don't remember, were you at that convention at the end of the convention, we recessed the convention and then called to order the Labor for McGovern Committee? And Dwayne,
in the same room,
in the
at
same
the same
room.
Time.
I left the. I had to leave the podium, obviously, because I thought there was going to be hell to pay. I thought, you know, maybe we were jeopardizing our charter by virtue of what we were doing. George Meany later said to me, "Why didn't you talk to your counterparts in other parts of the country to get them to do what you guys did in Montana?" I said, "Mr. President, I wasn't too sure I was going to survive that either." That boy, things were so tense. But the Labor for McGovern Committee was put together again. The emphasis on all of that was keeping that coalition together that had contributed so much to the union culture in Montana. And we did that, and we weren't going to win that. We weren't going to win that election. But what we did is we kept the coalition together. And with all of the differences we had at the state convention, at the national Democratic convention, you know, we were friends again, and we mm-hmm. and we worked together.
And carried on through the 70s, but we're going to run out of time, so we can't carry on for the rest of the 70s. But let's take a few questions, if we can, if people want to ask questions, and then we'll do a little wrap-up. Joan.
You worked a lot with the Farmers Union. Were they an outgrowth of the populists?
Now, what was this now?
The Farmers Union, you worked so much in coalition.
Yeah.
Was the Farmers Union, since they were progressive, was that part of populism?
Yes, it was part of that whole, that populist thing. But did you ever read the book, The Red Corner?
Mm-hmm.
That is a great book, and it's really a required reading. And if you remember talking in there about the people that were the communist activists at that time were really critical of the Farmers Union because they thought the Farmers Union was too conservative. You remember reading about that? I just love that. I just love, because then as the years went by, the Farmers Union leaders were accused of being socialists, communists. They weren't communists. Some of them were socialists. There's no question about that.
Watch for labels this year.
Yeah.
Next question. Another question. You know, John?
But yes, it was.
My question really wasn't about the time period. I didn't read that whole article about Jonathan Model. And,
right.
And I was wondering if you could speak about that finding that they had this week.
Well, just very quickly, they found Wittig guilty of violating campaign laws. Now, Jim was part of this. Jim was the guy to whom the box was shipped from Colorado with all the records in it. Magically, one day, there it was. It became a public record then, didn't it?
Yes, it did. And
we were there, by the way, last week on Thursday, the two of us, to watch the trial for a while.
God, it was great. And there will be an interesting decision coming from the judge, the quid pro quo issue, corruption, and if it's shown that Wittig did things for this, it was a National Right to Work Committee that underwrote the cost and putting all of that organization together. If he did something
in return,
then that can go to a corruption decision on the part of the judge, and that's really going to be
let me explain the importance. The penalty is going to be a fine. There was arguments over the cost of the benefits of the goods.
That's a civil case.
Okay, it's a civil case. The prosecution, the plaintiffs said, Model said it was about $20,000 worth of goods They said, oh, no, well, a lot less than that. Well, why would that be a concern? That's because the state law in Montana says you can have a fine up to 3 times the value of the contribution. So if it's a $20,000 contribution, it could be a $60,000 fine. If it's a $5,000 contribution, it could be a $15,000 fine. Secondly, the state will ask for his removal from office or not being able to ever run for office again. The judge has to make that decision. The final thing is determination of quid pro quo corruption. And the value of that is not inherent in the case itself here. It's a value for another case because all of our campaign laws are under assault by these same folks in federal court. And under Citizens United, Kennedy's decision was that money inherently was not evil, but it could lead to corruption. And if you could ever establish that the excess of money, the unlimited money and all that stuff under Citizens United had led to quid pro quo corruption, then you had the right to regulate it more stringently. And so for Montana now to defend its laws, to be able to go and say in court, it has been determined twice in Montana that there's quid pro quo corruption from this money, helps sustain our case as a state to keep our campaign contributions and the other elements of the statutes. So that's the what's out there now.
Now, one of the interesting things, too, and I'll try to touch on this really quickly. Remember when the group in Bozeman that Wittig was an attorney for came together? It was the American Tradition or Western
the Western, Western Tradition,
Tradition
Partnership.
It was then they changed it to the American Tradition Partnership. That group was brought together by a guy by the name of John Cinerud, who was a legislator from Bozeman, and Ron Marlaney, the former Republican congressman from the Eastern District. They came together for they brought this organization together for the purpose of focusing on the development of natural resources in Montana and the development of good paying natural resource jobs. And they were going to take, part of what they were going to do is they were going to take on radical environmentalists as they worked toward developing the energy resources and creating these good-paying jobs. It was the National Right to Work Committee that organized the whole thing.
They came in. They as part of that.
They not part of it.
They took it
they,
over.
They put. They were the ones that underwrote the whole thing to begin with.
Mm.
They were. It was a National Right to Work Committee. Now, do you think that they're all that interested in natural resources in Montana? You get the feeling maybe that was going to be an attack on workers and the collective bargaining process, right? I think it's fair to make that assumption. Well, they and the process of what they were doing, they became an independent political committee that by law can't coordinate with a campaign. You have to. There has to be an arm's length distance between the independent, just like at the national level. Well, what they showed the other day was there was coordination. There was direct coordination between Art Wittig and that and the Right to Work National Right to Work organization. I was in the commissioner's office. One of the worst things I ever allowed anybody to talk me into doing was becoming the commissioner on political practices. I was going to be there for 3 months. I couldn't get away. I was there for a year and a half. 78 years old at the time. I'm in court every day. Somebody was suing me every day. It was just crazy. But what we did is we were able to with that experience, we were able to put in motion all of these things that have developed with John Modell, who is doing a tremendous job. He's an attorney himself. And he's a good attorney, and he really knows those laws well. And he's really doing a superb job. They did a great job the other day. One other thing, the attorney, a guy by the name of Gene Gerusi, who has ties to Carbon County, where Evan grew up, his uncle was the chairman of the Carbon County Democratic Central Committee for years and was just a great old populist, was just really a great guy. He took that case and put in all of the hours that have gone into that case free gratis. He's not charging the state anything to do that. You don't find that kind of commitment.
And in fact, were it not for that, the state is kind of crippled by a lack of having enough money to hire good lawyers to fight the other side, which has all the money.
But that's how, and that's how the, that's how agencies and groups like the commissioner's office are limited in what we could do, because you never have the money to, you never have the money to do the job that needs to be done.
So we're going to have a parade for Gene Jerusi when it's all over, hopefully, not.
But anyhow, you asked the question, John. That could go on for 2 hours itself, couldn't it?
Other questions? We can take a couple more, maybe.
What would you consider the major issues for labor now in the legislature besides, like, right to work?
Well, I think all of those basic worker protection laws are in jeopardy now. Have been. We've seen a decline in benefits. I think the greatest challenge for the labor movement is I'm trying to figure out how to say this. Is to.
They've been decimated over the years in terms of membership.
There's not a Montana labor movement left. There's only 6% of the workers in the private sector workforce in Montana are in unions. 94 out of every 100 are not union. We, for decades, were one of the most highly unionized states in America, at around 40 to 50%. And we're down now to where there isn't a labor movement left in the private sector. The where the membership is with public employee organizations, teachers, the MEA-MFT, the MPEA, AFSCME. Those are the organizations that SEIU has a lot. Those are the organizations representing public employees that are the bulwark of what's left of the Montana labor movement and, in fact, the American labor movement. But one of the challenge to the movement, if I were there, I'd look at it this way, and I don't think anyone particularly cares how I feel about it anyway. But I think the challenge is to be able to define who we are as unionists and what we see the role of the trade union movement being. I happen to be, again, because of my industrial union background, I feel really strongly that we have to be closely tied to social movements, movements to bring about needed social change for everybody in this country. That was a strength of the labor movement. People liked us because we were right on so many of those issues, and we grew our labor movement a lot because of that identity that we had. We're kind of shrinking up, and one of the things that's happening is that I'm not trying to degrade the labor movement at all. I mean, I love the labor movement as much as life itself, believe me. But there's a real tendency for the labor movement to not set their own agendas and develop their own strategies. They respond to the pressure that's put on through the coal industry, for example. There's jobs down in eastern Montana, good paying jobs. The labor movement has to be there for them, but the coal industry as a whole is a not anti-union industry. It has been through the history of the history of the nation, and it's good to be supportive where we can be supportive, but to get wrapped up with industries supporting industries, to me, is kind of crazy. Just let me close with this. In the old days during strikes, we used to see, you'd see during a strike situation, there would be signs in people's windows. We're sticking with the strikers. We're with the strikers, whatever the unions were. Remember how that was? That would happen. And we used that technique all over Montana to bring communities together so that strikers would have, the workers would have community support. We'd go to mainline churches, ask for their support, and the support there was always overwhelming. If you look now, if you look at the signs that go into windows, you never see that anymore. We're not talking about supporting workers. We're talking about supporting industries. We support the timber industry. We support the mining industry. We support, but you don't see, ever see anything about just supporting workers and their families. I would want to, I think that's a challenge. And I think what's going on in the labor movement, there's some people wondering about maybe we need to change our mission.
Let me wrap up with something. I mentioned Jim's role as being seen as one of the more powerful men in Montana. In 1971, after the sales tax election, the Republican editor of the Billings Gazette wrote a nice editorial about Jim Lucas. But in it, he said, as stated, Jim Lucas is not naive or stupid. He said, Lucas also knows the quality of the Democratic opposition. Under Governor Forrest Anderson, or because of the chemistry his election made possible, the Democrats have forged a formidable political front. Clyde Jarvis of the Farmers Union, Ron Richards of the Governor's Office, Jim Murry of the AFL-CIO, and Evan Barrett of the Democratic Central Committee Executive Secretary are capable political performers. Contrast this lineup in the driver's seat with the Republican maneuvering at the state level. Basically, that spoke to both leadership. I didn't belong in that group, but I was mentioned there, and I'm pleased to have been mentioned in the company of those three guys. But it also spoke to the coalitions that Jim spoke of. And so those coalitions were recognized and carried on through the 70s and made a difference. And when we talk about the period of progressive change, Jim's discussion of coalitions is probably the greatest. But there's leadership is an important part of it, and individual human beings make a difference in leadership. And Jim Murry sure did that, and frankly, as far as I'm concerned, continues to. So let's say thanks to Jim, okay?
Thank you. Thank you very much.